Hello and welcome to this Snapcast dealing with practical observation and deduction exercises in GCE or A-level chemistry. The observations and deductions come in pairs of activities. One involves an inorganic exercise and the other an organic exercise. The inorganic exercise typically involves the analysis of so-called double salts. Though one of the ions in these mixed salts is common to both salts. Here are two examples. One might be given sodium sulfate and sodium chloride, white crystalline ionic salts. And you'll notice there that sodium is common to both salts. We will be looking to identify the presence of sodium, sulfate and chloride ions. Another example, calcium carbonate and calcium chloride. Here calcium is common to both salts. So we're looking to identify the presence of calcium, carbonate and chloride ions. So we'll begin with the inorganic observation and deduction exercises, and then later we'll take a look at organic observation and deduction. This is typically the instruction that's given before you would start the exercise. You'd be wearing safety glasses or safety goggles at all times. You're provided with two unknown substances, 3 grams of substance labelled A, 5 cubic centimetres of a solution labelled B. And then you're asked to carry out a set of experiments to identify as best you can what you've got in A and in B. Right, here's an inorganic observation and deduction exercise. You'd be asked to describe the appearance of this solid, typically a double salt, and then you're given a set of instructions to carry out. In this particular exercise, it was white in colour and it was a solid. Don't forget to state the obvious. In the next case, we're adding the solid to water, so we're looking to see, does it dissolve? In this case, it does dissolve. We'll get a mark for that. There was a mark, by the way, for white solid there. Does it form a coloured or a colourless solution when it dissolves? It forms a colourless solution, and one will get a mark for that. And we're asked to record the temperature. Does it dissolve, raising the temperature or causing the temperature to fall? In this case, the temperature falls, and that observation gains a mark. Next, we're using silver nitrate, acidified silver nitrate, acidified typically with nitric acid. This is a test for halide ions in solution, followed up by testing whether the silver halide dissolves in ammonia. One test to see if it dissolves in dilute ammonia, and then in concentrated ammonia if it doesn't dissolve in dilute ammonia. We'll look at this in a little bit more detail in a moment. In this particular case, we get a white precipitate mark for that. In the case of adding dilute ammonia, it does dissolve, so the precipitate redissolves. Get a mark for that. And a mark for stating the obvious, a solution is formed. When it dissolves, one ends up with a colourless solution. You see that some of these are quite obvious things, but things that you may not have considered stating or writing down. Then we add a spatula measure of A to a test tube, 1/3 full of dilute sodium hydroxide solution, and we warm it. Now, once you see a chemical being warmed with an alkali, you're thinking in terms of identifying the presence of an ammonium compound. If you warm an ammonium compound with an alkali, you'll get a salt ammonia gas and water formed, and the ammonia gas can be identified using a glass rod dipped into concentrated hydrochloric acid. The NH3, if produced, will react with HCl to form white smoke of ammonium chloride. If you test it with pH paper, if you moisten the pH paper, ammonia is an alkaline gas. It will dissolve to form ammonium hydroxide, and it will turn the indicator paper blue in colour. First observation is that it dissolves, forming a colourless solution. One gets a mark for that. Next, one sees bubbling or effervescence. That's the gas coming off. The gas, ammonia, has a pungent smell. In this case, we do get ammonia produced, so pungent smell. And the moist universal indicator turns blue or purple. Get a mark for that. So a total of four marks there. Mark for each of those: dissolving to form a colourless solution, bubbles or effervescence, a pungent smell, means a very strong smell, and the moist indicator paper turning blue or purple. Here you see the observations. Pause for a moment and consider the deductions that would be required here. What can you read into the fact that the sample is white in colour? Well, this tells us that it is not a transition metal. It's most likely to be a compound of a metal in either group 1 or group 2. The transition elements form compounds that are coloured. The fact that it dissolves, forming a colourless solution with the temperature dropping. Well, simple things, and these again you may find difficulty working out exactly what's required, and that's why this particular snapcast is important, to draw your attention to what you're expected to state. And the fact that the temperature drops is looking for you to deduce that the reaction is endothermic. A white precipitate form that redissolves in dilute ammonia, it's expecting you to deduce that the chloride ion must be present, because when you add acidified silver nitrate 20 chloride solution, you get silver chloride produced, which is insoluble, and silver chloride will dissolve in dilute ammonia. Silver bromide is also white or off-white in color, but it does not dissolve in dilute ammonia. It requires concentrated ammonia to dissolve silver bromide. What it wants us to state here is that the reason that it is dissolving in dilute ammonia solution is that a soluble complex is forming. Bear that in mind. And here, as we discussed earlier, it's an indication that ammonia gas is being produced. That's what's causing the bubbling. That's what's turning the moist indicator paper blue-purple in colour. And we deduce, therefore, that we have an ammonium compound present, or the ammonium ion present. And here you see the deductions that were required. So we've established that we had the ammonium ion and the chloride ion present, so ammonium chloride. Picking up on the theory here, to identify the presence of chloride, bromide and iodide here, as you see, one uses an acidified silver nitrate solution. You take some silver nitrate and add a few drops of nitric acid to acidify it, and then you add that in turn to each of these test tubes. In the case of the chloride, you get a white precipitate. In the case of the bromide, you get an off-white or cream precipitate. In the case of the iodide, you get a yellow precipitate. In each case, you're forming an insoluble silver halide. Each of these is a precipitation reaction. So you're getting silver chloride reacting with silver nitrate. And as was indicated in the previous slide, they're swapping partners. The sodium of the sodium bromide takes the nitrate of the silver nitrate, and the silver of the silver nitrate takes the bromide of the sodium bromide. They're swapping partners, and of key importance is all of the silver halides are insoluble, and that precipitates out. And here we see the specific cases. the chloride producing white precipitate of silver chloride, the bromide producing a cream or off-white precipitate of silver bromide, and the iodide forming a yellow precipitate of silver iodide. This is a mnemonic or memory device that you could use to remember it. As we go down group 7, we have fluorine, chlorine, bromine, and iodine. We don't consider fluorine chemistry. And if you want to remember the colors of the silver chloride, silver bromide, and silver iodide, this is a mnemonic, why can't you? White, cream, yellow might help you. The silver halides, you'll recall, are two of them are light sensitive, namely the chloride and the bromide, and if they're left to sit for some time, for a few minutes, you will see that white precipitate of silver chloride begin to darken, and indeed the silver bromide as well. Silver bromide is used in photography. It's the light sensitive chemical that coats photographic film and paper. Silver iodide is not light sensitive. In terms of solubility in ammonia solution, we see here that the silver chloride is white in color and it will dissolve in dilute ammonia. And of course, if it dissolves in dilute ammonia solution, it'll also dissolve in concentrated ammonia solution. Silver bromide is cream or off-white. It is difficult when seen separately to tell the difference between the chloride and the bromide, and that's why the second part of the test is necessary. One can distinguish between silver chloride and silver bromide using dilute ammonia, because silver bromide is not soluble in dilute ammonia, but it is soluble in concentrated ammonia. I've produced a separate video cast that demonstrates these reactions. And then you've silver iodide, which is yellow in color, and it is insoluble in both dilute and concentrated ammonia. Moving on. Showing up the presence of the ammonium ion, you'll have learnt in GCSE this general reaction, that an ammonium compound will react with an alkali, typically sodium hydroxide alkali chosen. You warm it gently and you get a salt, ammonia gas and water. And the ammonia gas can be tested using either moist UI paper, which will turn blue or blue-purple in colour, or better still, to use a glass rod dipped into concentrated hydrochloric acid, and that will form a white smoke when brought in contact with ammonia. Here's one example, ammonium chloride, an example of an ammonium compound reacting with an alkali, sodium hydroxide, giving a salt, ammonia and water. Here's another example. Different ammonium compound, ammonium sulfate, reacting with a different alkali, calcium hydroxide, but again you get a salt, ammonia and water formed. And here we see a better test for HCl gas. Should be a small L there. That should be HC, lowercase l. What happens is out of here comes NH3, which is a colourless gas. Out of here comes HCl, again a colourless gas, and where they meet you may just about see the white smoke being produced there. This is another illustration to the right of the same thing. You can therefore use concentrated ammonia solution to test for HCl, and you can use concentrated hydrochloric acid, which gives off HCl, to test for ammonia. Here's a typical GCSE type question that involves this chemistry. Describe how you would carry out the test for hydrogen chloride gas and state what you would observe. You would observe white fumes or a white smoke. You would use a glass rod that's dipped into concentrated ammonia to test for HCl. Looking at it the other way around, a test for hydrogen chloride, then you would dip the glass rod into concentrated ammonia solution. Have I got that the right way? Or the reverse case, a test for ammonia, you would use concentrated hydrochloric acid. Moving on to the next question. Here we have, again, some practical exercises to carry out and observations to be made. just read down through those for a moment before we look at what was observed. And this is what was observed. First of all, in describing X, X was a white solid, so you get a mark for simply stating that. White in colour and a solid. Then you're asked to place a spatula measure of X onto a watch glass, add a drop of concentrated hydrochloric acid, so this is the flame test. You clean the nichrome wire by dipping it into acid to clean it. Then you pick up some of the sample and put it in a blue or non-luminous flame, and this is what you see. You get a lilac colour being imparted to the flame. That's your observation. Next, you carefully add a spatula measure of X to a test tube 1/4 full of hydrochloric acid and test the gas. So it's telling us a gas comes off. If you're adding acid and getting a gas, you should be suspecting the carbonate ion, CO32-, or indeed the hydrogen carbonate ion, HCO3-, because an acid will react with a carbonate to give a salt, CO2 gas, and water. You get the same result with the hydrogen carbonate. The observations that you were expected to note were, first of all, and this is where some students, quite a few students, will lose a mark for failing to state the obvious. To begin with, it dissolved and formed a colourless solution. The fact that you've got bubbling, or technically it's better to say effervescence, and then testing the gas, it turns lime water milky. A way of doing this is to take two test tubes alongside one another like so, put lime water in here, just put LW for lime water there, and carry a reaction out here between your acid and your solid, and the gas, CO2, will come out. It's heavier than air. It'll fall into the test tube on the right, and it should turn the lime water milky. Then here, dissolving a spatula measure of X in a test tube 1/4 full of water, and using a glass rod, place a drop of the solution onto pH paper. So we're testing to see if the solution is acidic, neutral, or alkaline. In this particular case, it forms a solution that is alkaline. In year 14, we study an aspect called salt hydrolysis. And I've made a snapcast that deals with that, and that helps you to elucidate something about the ions that are present in this particular salt. You are also to observe a white precipitate formed, and a colourless solution. Now, I myself find this particularly difficult. What's happening here is you're supposed to hone in on the fact that magnesium nitrate is used to test for carbonate ions using an ionic equation or partial ionic equation to show what's happening here. These two aqueous solutions react to form insoluble magnesium carbonate. You'll also get formed a second salt that is soluble, and that's the significance, I assume, of the colourless solution. So again, not exactly obvious, and one has to learn from the snapcast here what's required of you in each of these instances. Let's move on to the deductions that we can make from these observations. White solid again indicates that it's not a transition metal, so a non-transition metal, probably a group 1 or group 2 metal compound. Lilac indicates potassium present. The production of CO2 gas here, as identified by the lime water turning cloudy or milky, indicates the presence of either the CO32- ion or the HCO3- ion. And the white precipitate formed with the magnesium nitrate, again, that indicates the presence of the carbonate ion. So you can see we've got potassium ions here and we've got carbonate ions. Pause a moment and just take in all of this information. And just a summary of the background theory here. Potassium, this is the colour of the potassium flame, or the flame test for potassium. We get a lilac colour imparted to the flame. using that test for carbonate ions with acid, then this is the way in which you could do it. I've demonstrated here. You would have the acid added to the carbonate in this test tube, some lime water here, and fairly quickly, just within 10 seconds or so, you do notice the lime water turning milky. What is happening here is that the CO2 being produced here falls into the second test tube because CO2 is heavier than air, and it turns the lime water cloudy. In the test for carbonate using magnesium nitrate, I've demonstrated what happens here. We get here the white precipitate formed, and that's magnesium carbonate that's forming. We'll also get a second salt which is soluble, and that's the significance of the solution that's being produced. So again, not terribly happy with that second observation, but learn from the Mark scheme answer here what's required. And this slide here shows you the key equations. The reaction of any carbonate with an acid forms CO2 and water. A salt will also be formed, as is indicated in this specific example. We had potassium carbonate. If you add hydrochloric acid as well as the CO2 and water, then you'll get potassium chloride formed. And the precipitation reaction, we take two soluble salts, in this case AB aqueous and CD aqueous. They swap partners. The A takes the D and the C takes the B. And in this case, AD is insoluble and CB is soluble. So you're getting a precipitate and you're also getting a solution formed of the other salt. This is an example here, not the specific example we're dealing with here, but an example of a precipitation reaction. The use of silver nitrate to show up the presence of chloride ions. And the silver nitrate solution and the sodium chloride meet to form, in this case, silver chloride precipitate. One would also get sodium nitrate formed as a solution. Returning to our example in this question, we have carbonate reacting with magnesium forming insoluble magnesium carbonate. And the full equation is shown down here. Potassium carbonate solution reacting with magnesium, nitrate here, not chloride. So it would be magnesium nitrate reacting with potassium carbonate. And instead of getting potassium chloride, we get potassium nitrate, of course. Moving on. Another double salt to identify. Pause a moment and read the information here. Here are the observations that were made. So a white solid again, and that's an indication that it's a non-transition metal. These are various solutions of various transition metals here. And you see lots of different colors showing up. You add a half spatula measure of A to a test tube, half full of sodium hydroxide and warm. So again, we're testing for the ammonium ion here. If you're warming with an alkali like sodium hydroxide, you're looking for effervescence, a pungent gas that turns moist indicator paper blue or blue-purple. That would be showing up ammonia and therefore the presence of the ammonium ion. And we see here that it does dissolve and it forms a colorless solution. When the gas is tested, so we should be mentioning bubbles here. No marks for any bubbling, but we are getting a pungent gas, pungent smelling gas. And when the damp UI paper is put in there, it's turning blue. So this is showing up the fact that ammonia gas is being produced. Test the gas evolved by dipping glass rod into concrete Cl. And again, we're getting the white fumes resulting from the NH3 that's being formed, reacting with the HCl coming off from the glass rod, producing ammonium chloride, a white smoke. We're then doing the flame test here. And we're getting a red flame. There's a problem with red because several metals give a red flame colour. We've got lithium gives a crimson red. Lithium or any compound of lithium put into a non-luminous flame will produce a red colour, described as crimson red. Calcium gives a brick red colour. And also strontium gives a red as well. So we wouldn't be expected to discriminate between these. Dissolve a spatula measure of A in 2 cubic centimetres of dilute nitric acid and add silver nitrate. So we've got acidified silver nitrate. We're testing for the presence of halide ions. We're getting a white precipitate, which might be silver chloride or might be silver bromide. Picking up on the idea of colour here, I've illustrated or shown you pictures here of a number of different transition metals. Here's cobalt, atomic number 27, and this is the colour of cobalt chloride. Potassium chromate has got the chromium transition metal present, and look at its colour, it's yellow. And here's nickel chloride at the bottom right, and there's the where nickel is in the transition element block. And again, the various colours that transition metal salt solutions appear. Pause here and see if you could get most of the colours of these solutions. What colour is a copper 2 solution? An iron 2 solution? Iron 3? Cobalt 2? Have a go. The answers are coming up. This is something you would only be able to do in year 14, of course, at least to be able to complete all of these, but you might know some in AS. Here are the answers. So copper 2 solution is typically blue, iron 2 green, iron 3 yellow, yellow brown, cobalt pink, nickel 2 solutions typically deep green. Chromium also deep green, chromate yellow, which I sort of said chromium 3 there, of course, and dichromate, which is chromium in the plus 6 oxidation state, orange, manganese 2, pale pink in colour, and permanganate you'll have come across in junior science, deep purple in colour. It's got the manganese in the plus 7 oxidation state. Again, we saw that slide earlier that shows where the ammonia gas is coming from and why it shows up the presence of the ammonium ion. And again, the test for ammonia gas. And why did the indicator paper turn blue or blue-purple? This is universal indicator solution added to ammonia solution, a dilute ammonia solution. You see the purple colour that you get there, indicating a pH of around about 11. In terms of the significance of the red colour imparted to the flame in the flame test, we see the colours here imparted by lithium compounds, calcium compounds and strontium. Showing up the presence of the halide ions again. The general equation silver nitrate plus sodium X gives AgX, the silver halide, plus sodium nitrate. This is a solution, soluble solution. Silver chloride is white, silver bromide is off-white or cream, silver iodide is yellow. And we see an illustration of the precipitation here on the right. And here are the deductions that one is required to make. White, that the fact that it is and not a transition element, that it's likely to be a group 1 or group 2 metal, or could be an ammonium salt as well, but certainly not a transition metal salt, or doesn't contain any transition metal. The fact that it dissolves and it's giving off this pungent gas is indication of the presence of the ammonium ion. The fact that the pH was above 7 tells us that it's alkaline in nature. The red flame, as you see, We can't distinguish between lithium, strontium, and calcium since all three give red colors. We could use a device called a polarimeter, which would distinguish between the different shades of red, of course. And the white precipitate with the silver nitrate test is an indication probably of the chloride ion, that could be bromide. Without testing to see if it dissolves in dilute ammonia, we can't be sure of that. But chloride was accepted in this particular case. Moving on to another question. Just pause yourself and look at this briefly. And by what you're being asked to do, at this stage you should begin to get an idea of what's likely to be present. So again, warming with an alkali, testing for the presence of the ammonium ion, backed up by the fact that damp UI paper should turn blue or blue-purple in colour, and testing for the NH3 using HCl. We've got a flame test here, and we're using acidified barium chloride. What is barium chloride used to test for? It's used to show up the presence of the sulfate ion, SO42 minus aqueous. Here are the observations that one got in this experiment. A white solid, so it rules out a transition metal being present. This is all about the fact that NH3 has been given off, and therefore we are confirming the presence of the ammonium ion. A yellow colour, which particular element gives a yellow flame test? That of course is showing up the presence of sodium or the sodium ion. A white precipitate with barium chloride is a positive test for the sulfate ion in solution. This is some pictures I took of this test for the sulfate ion using barium chloride. Some sources might mention barium nitrate. Your syllabus talks about using barium chloride solution. And here we have the two solutions, the solution of barium chloride and the solution of your salt. And here you see you get a white precipitate formed of barium sulfate, and here's the partial ionic equation showing what's happening. The barium ions from the barium chloride solution react with your sulfate ions in your sample, and they produce barium sulfate, which is insoluble. Looking at the deductions now, the white solid again ruling out the transition metal, so it's going to be either group 1, group 2 metal or an ammonium salt. This is confirming the presence of the ammonium ion, but again, watch out for stating some simple obvious things. If you fail to do so, you'll lose this mark. The fact that the universal indicator paper turned blue indicates that it's alkaline or that it has a pH above 7. Yellow, confirming the presence of sodium ions. White precipitate with barium chloride showing up the presence of sulfate. So we've got ammonium and sulfate, and we've got sodium as well with sulfate. Again, you've seen this before, the equations that show why ammonia being produced by heating your compound with an alkali does indicate the presence that you have the ammonium ion, indicates the presence of the ammonium ion. And the significance of the test with NH3 using HCl. And why the paper turns blue or purple with UI paper. And the colour, this is the colour you get described as orange-yellow for sodium and sodium compounds. And if we take a look at the equations for the reaction where barium chloride reacts with the sulfate ions, this is it here. So we've got our barium nitrate, in fact your syllabus is using chloride ion, barium chloride, and together they react, as you see here, barium chloride reacting with, for example, copper sulfate, giving insoluble barium sulfate and copper chloride. So as one enters the other, you'll get the precipitate formed, which is shown here at the top right. This is how we produce what's known as a complete ionic equation. We simply split all these bits up into their ions. You've got barium and chloride ions present in barium chloride. You've got copper and sulfate ions present in copper sulfate. You get barium sulfate together with copper and chloride ions. You then get rid of the so-called spectator ions, and you boil it down then to the calcium sulfate and the barium and the sulfate, giving barium sulfate. And this is therefore properly known as a net ionic equation down here. We showed up the presence of sodium ions using the flame test. We got orange-yellow. We showed up the presence of the ammonium ions by warming our compound with an alkali sodium hydroxide and testing for ammonia using damp universal indicator paper, which turned blue, or dipping a glass rod into concentrated hydrochloric acid and getting a white smoke. We tested for the presence of sulfate ions using barium chloride, acidified barium chloride. Trying another one, another inorganic exercise. A is a sample of two salts, so again a double salt. Pause and take a look at the test you're required to carry out here. Again, it should be, you should at this stage be able to narrow down what you're testing for. So we've got a flame test here. We're adding acid and we're looking for bubbling and identifying the gas. Looks like a carbonate or a hydrogen carbonate possibly. And here, magnesium nitrate we saw earlier is testing for the presence of the carbonate ion. Now this looks like a repetition because we saw that we were testing for up here with an acid, we're testing for the presence of carbonate, but this could also be given by a hydrogen carbonate ion. So we'll be able to put some facts together here depending on the results of the experiment. And barium chloride, of course, is testing for the presence of the sulfate ion. Acidified barium chloride will form a white precipitate if sulfate is present. Let's see what was observed. So we got fizzing with the acid. That's simply repeated down here for different reasons in a moment. The flame test showed up as yellow-orange, so that's showing the presence of the sodium ion, certainly there. Again, we're adding acid to it. In the first instance, this was a sort of a byproduct of a different test, namely doing the flame test, but here they are properly now looking for the presence of the carbonate or hydrogen carbonate ion. So we get fizzing and it dissolves. Again, remember to state the obvious, that you get bubbles, but also the fact that the solid disappears and is dissolving. This is showing up the presence of either the hydrogen carbonate ion or the carbonate ion. You can't distinguish between the two, so it's one or other of these is present. The fact that the gas coming off turned lime water milky again is simply confirming that we have one of these present. Then we add magnesium nitrate, which is testing for the presence of the carbonate ion, and we see that no precipitate is formed. That means that we can go back up here and rule out the carbonate and rule in the hydrogen carbonate. And the test for the sulfate ions with barium chloride is showing up as a white precipitate. So we do indeed have sulfate ions present. So on this slide here you can see the three ions that are present in this double salt. Namely, we've got sodium ions from the yellow-orange flame test. We've got hydrogen carbonate ions on the basis that when warmed with when an acid was added to the salt, we got bubbling, and yet there was no carbonate present, as indicated by the fact that we had a negative test for carbonate using magnesium nitrate. And then we have sulfate as well. So these are the deductions then. Pause and just take in this information for a moment then. So again, we've got sodium ions, hydrogen carbonate ions, and sulfate ions. What does that mean that we have? Well, the only positive ion we have is the sodium ion. So sodium is present in both of these salts. And then we've got the hydrogen carbonate ion, so we have NaHCO3, and we have the sulfate ion, Na2SO4. Another question. Another double salt. Pause and take a look at the tests and try to see what ions might be present on the basis of what you're being asked to do. So we've got a flame test here. We've got a test for a halide ion using acidified silver nitrate here. And we're warming with sodium hydroxide, warming with an alkali, so we're testing for the ammonium ion here. So ammonium here. We're looking for a halide ion here. And the flame test showing up a metal, presumably. Here are the observations. The test using acidified silver nitrate is showing up a white precipitate. Could be the chloride or the bromide, therefore. You're using dilute ammonia. The precipitate is dissolving, so that's ruling out the bromide, ruling in the chloride. We're getting a yellow or orange-yellow flame test, so that's showing that we've got sodium ions present. But again, pick up on the obvious that needs to be stated to gain the marks for observations. Warming with the alkali here, stating the obvious that it dissolves, you're getting this pungent gas or fume, you're getting fumes produced. And in terms of the indicator, it's turning blue or purple, dark green, blue or purple is accepted. In other words, it's alkaline. Again, all showing up the fact that ammonia is being produced, and therefore we must have the ammonium ion present. So already we're seeing what's present in this compound. We must have chloride ions present, sodium ions present, and ammonium ions present. So there are your deductions. So we have sodium chloride and ammonium chloride. Moving on to another question. Pause again and tune into what you're testing for here. Here you're making up acidified silver nitrate, and here you're making up acidified barium chloride. So here you're testing with barium chloride for the presence of SO4 2- ions in solution, and here you're testing for the halide ion in solution. Here it's telling us to go into the fume cupboard, something nasty being produced. And when I see concentrated sulfuric acid being added, I'm thinking in terms of group 7. I'm thinking in terms of something like a silver halide being reacted with concentrated sulfuric acid. And what's forming then is the hydrogen halide, HX plus NaHSO4. This is a gas, the balance that we need a 2 in there. So we're testing here for the presence of a halide ion. We'll look at the details of that chemistry, which is quite complex, in a moment. Now, just as we can test for HCl using NH3, it forms a white smoke of NH4Cl. Similarly, a hydrogen bromide would react with NH3, forming again a white smoke of ammonium bromide. So just as you can use ammonia to test for hydrogen chloride, you can use ammonia to test for hydrogen bromide. And what's happening here in this particular test? Again, the flame test. So we're looking for halide ion, sulfate ion, and we're looking for, in the flame test, some metal ion. Here are the observations that were made. We're getting a white precipitate, so that's indicating either the presence of the fact that silver chloride is formed, or perhaps silver bromide. We don't have any follow-up with ammonia, so we can't necessarily distinguish between the two here. And some of the obvious that needs to be stated, namely that it dissolves, forming a colourless solution. Getting the white precipitate here with the silver nitrate. We're also getting a white precipitate with the acidified barium chloride, so that's showing up the fact that sulfate ions are present. When we add the concentrated sulfuric acid, we're getting a gas indicated by the fizzing or bubbling. Remember, this is being done in a fume cupboard, so something nasty is being produced here. The fact that the reaction is exothermic, you are to use four of your five senses. What do you see? What do you smell? What do you hear? What do you feel? You don't taste anything, of course. So if you feel the test tube, heat is generated. It's warming up. You're getting steamy white fumes produced. When you test it with universal indicator paper, damp universal indicator paper is turning red, so you're getting something acidic formed, certainly not ammonia, therefore. And when you use concentrated ammonia on a glass rod, you're getting a white smoke. So again, that could be what you're forming there is either ammonium chloride or ammonium bromide. We'll pick up on the detailed theory on that in a moment. And the flame test is giving yellow-orange, which is indicating presence of sodium. So confirmed at this stage, definitely we have sulfate ions, definitely we have sodium ions. Question is, do we have chloride ions or bromide ions produced? Now, concentrated sulfuric acid is also an oxidizing agent. And when it forms either the hydrogen chloride, if we're dealing with a chloride ion in this double salt, or forms hydrogen bromide, if we have a bromide ion present in the salt, there is a difference. Concentrated hydrochloric acid, when it forms the hydrogen chloride gas, it is not a sufficiently strong oxidizing agent to oxidize hydrogen chloride to chlorine, but it is a sufficiently strong oxidizing agent to oxidize hydrogen bromide to produce some bromine. And if it had been a bromide, we would have got bromine produced, and one would have observed a brown gas formed. Now, the fact that there was no mention or no observation of a brown gas allows me to conclude that it's the chloride that's present. So we've identified the ions in this double salt as follows. We've got the only positive ion is the sodium ion, and in terms of negative ions, we've got the chloride ion, and we have the sulfate ion. Just pause here and take in the significance of each of these. We haven't gone into the details of group 7 chemistry here with conch sulfuric acid, simply accepting that this is the chloride here, though I can't see why they haven't indicated that it could be bromide as well, especially since they haven't used the ammonia solution, which would distinguish, dilute ammonia would distinguish between the chloride and the bromide. White precipitate indicates the sulfate ions, of course, with barium chloride solution. The fact that the indicator paper, damp indicator paper, turns red, simply showing that it's acidic. The white smoke, well, that could be produced by either hydrogen chloride or ammonium chloride, is accepted, but the white smoke is ammonium chloride, of course, formed by the reaction of the NH3 on the rod with HCl. Sorry, the HCl is on the glass rod, of course. And we get ammonium chloride formed. And the yellow-orange color showing up sodium. Moving on to another question. Another double salt. Very similar to the previous one here. We've got acidified silver nitrate and acidified barium chloride. We have a flame test. Sorry, no, here we've got, again, similarly, we're using concentrated sulfuric acid. Again, we're testing with damp universal indicator paper and with concentrated ammonia. We're looking for the presence of either HCl or possibly HBr. And we have the flame test down here at the bottom. So let's see what observations we get on this occasion. So stating the obvious, that it dissolves to form a colorless solution. We we're getting a cream or an off-white precipitate. So certainly this observation is tending towards bromide this time rather than chloride. We're getting a white precipitate with the barium chloride, so that's definitely showing up the presence of the sulfate ions. Down here straightforwardly we're getting a yellow-orange flame, so that's showing up straightforwardly the presence of sodium ions. Now here's the distinction that I mentioned just a few moments ago about the concentrated sulfuric acid. When it comes to a halide ion being present, chloride versus bromide, when you add concentrated sulfuric acid, that will give you either HCl or HBr. Concentrated sulfuric acid cannot oxidize the hydrogen chloride, but it is a sufficiently strong oxidizing agent to oxidize hydrogen bromide, and it will produce bromine, which is a red-brown color. That's why we're doing this in the fume cupboard. These are nasty substances, particularly bromine, that we're producing. Observations, we're getting a gas produced, that's the effervescence. If you feel the test tube, it warms up, so we have an exothermic reaction. We're getting brown fumes, that's the bromine that's being produced as a result of the conch sulfuric acid initially changing the bromide to hydrogen bromide, but then oxidizing the hydrogen bromide to bromine, which is a brown gas. The indicator paper, damp indicator paper, is turning red, so we have an acidic substance being formed, acidic gas, and a white smoke. What's happening here is the HBr, not all the HBr gets oxidized to bromine. HBr is reacting there just as HCl does with the ammonia, producing again a white smoke of ammonium bromide. So now we've found what's present. We've definitely got bromide ions present, sulfate ions present, and sodium ions. So sodium bromide and sodium sulfate, of course. This is with the chloride. We've realized now it's the bromide that's present. So you get hydrogen bromide formed. And down here at the bottom, the ammonia is reacting with hydrogen bromide to form ammonium bromide. Just pause and take that information in. So if this had been HBr here instead, we are forming a white smoke of NH4Br here. Pause if you need to and take in the information. This was a particularly difficult experiment, complex experiment. You may wish to go into the theory of this yourself, and it would be worth your while then pausing these slides and making some notes on the information presented here. If we take as an example of a bromide, potassium bromide, it's reacting here with the concentrated, notice liquid for concentrated sulfuric acid, to form potassium hydrogen sulfate and hydrogen bromide, which will be a gas. While concentrated sulfuric acid cannot oxidize HCl, it can oxidize HBr, and it produces bromine and sulfur dioxide, a poisonous gas, and water. So you'll observe a reddish vapor resulting from that. Why is this considered a sulfuric acid behaving as an oxidizing agent? If you look at the oxidation number of the bromine and hydrogen bromide, it's -1. In bromine, Br2, like in any element, it's 0. The oxidation number is being increased from -1 to 0, and by definition that's oxidation. The sulfur dioxide produced is an acidic gas. Sulfur dioxide is also a reducing agent. A test for a reducing agent is that it decolorizes purple potassium permanganate. We might as well take a look at what would happen with the other halide, namely iodide. If you took potassium iodide, potassium iodide will react with concentrated sulfuric acid to form hydrogen iodide, and concentrated sulfuric acid will oxidize the hydrogen iodide, and in fact you get a whole series of complex reactions taking place that you would not need to know. We should have arrows here, sorry. And what will be produced is a range of things. You'll notice there, for example, that when you react potassium iodide with sulfuric acid, while it looks as if you just get potassium sulfate and hydrogen iodide there, in fact the hydrogen iodide goes on to form a whole range of things with the acid SO2, you get some iodine, you get some sulfur, you get some hydrogen sulfide gas that has the smell of rotting eggs. And you might want to pause just to look at some of the observations that would be made. But this is part of your group 7 chemistry. In summary, concentrated sulfuric acid can be reacted with sodium halide to form the hydrogen halide. While concentrated sulfuric acid does not oxidize hydrogen chloride, it does oxidize both hydrogen bromide and hydrogen iodide. So you get a whole series of different chemicals, a whole series of different reactions taking place. And here's a summary of all that you've seen there. Should be an arrow there. And there, and there, and there, I believe. Okay, that completes our look at inorganic observations and deductions. Let's move on now in the second part to take a look at organic observations and deductions. Remember again that your exercise is generally in two parts. In the first part, you are required to identify the ions present in a double salt. And here in the second part, then, you are given... Okay, sorry about that interruption. Anyway, in the second part of the observation deduction exercise, you're given an organic sample, most often a liquid, and asked to identify it. The ones that we'll be looking for will be a hydrocarbon. So we'll be looking for an alkane or an alkene. If it's an alkene, we'll be looking using bromine water probably to test for the presence of the carbon-carbon double bond. We'll be burning it. Possibly setting it on fire and taking a look at whether it burns with a clean flame or smoky flame, and we'll be able to read into that, as you'll see. We'll also be looking then for possibly an alcohol, and there we'll be testing, for example, to see if it will undergo oxidation, perhaps with orange potassium dichromate, and in the process turning the dichromate green. We'll possibly be looking at an iodoform reaction. We may set it on fire as well. Alcohols burn with a clean blue flame. We may be looking at a haloalkane, also known of course as an alkyl halide or halogenoalkane. And we'd be looking for carboxylic acids. Okay, so let's make a start and see what we're coming up with here. So describe the mixture B. So you take a look at your sample and you're informed that B is a mixture of hydrocarbons. So it could be a mixture, it could be just all alkanes. Both parts of the mixture could be an alkane, or one could be an alkene and the other an alkane, or whatever. You then add 2 cubic centimeters to water. So you're testing to see if it's miscible with water or soluble in water. One would expect that it shouldn't be. Alkanes and alkenes are non-polar, water's polar, and of course we have the rule like dissolves like, so one would expect them to be immiscible or insoluble in one another. Place 10 drops of B on a watch glass and ignite it. So we're going to take a look at the flame to see how sooty it is. Now we'll see how the carbon to hydrogen ratio, or we could look at the hydrogen to carbon ratio, how that is significant in terms of looking at or elucidating from the sootiness of the flame the ratio of carbon to hydrogen, but we'll look in detail at that in a few moments. And then we're testing here using bromine water. You see a sample of it here. It's described as an orange-brown colour, and there you're testing for the presence of the carbon-carbon double bond present in alkenes. Here are the observations that would be made. So it's a mixture of two hydrocarbons. It's seen to be colourless or slightly yellow, pale yellow in colour. And you describe its smell. So you get a mark for saying either that its color is colorless or yellow, light pale yellow. You get a mark for saying that it's liquid, again stating the obvious. And any reference to its smell, such as the fact that it's got a hydrocarbon smell or an oily smell, will gain you the other mark. In terms of whether it's immiscible with water or not, which turns out that it's immiscible as we would expect, you'll get two layers. You may just see the interface between the layers here. And when you burn it, it's described as having a smoky flame, so you get a mark for saying it's smoky, and that the flame and colour is yellow. So there's the yellow and there's the smoke. Make sure that you mention both. And then you're testing it with this orange-brown bromine water. You get a mark for stating the obvious, that the bromine water is orange or red-orange in colour. And the fact that when shaken with the sample, it turns colourless. So we definitely have an alkene present in this mixture of hydrocarbons. It goes from that to that. Now what can we deduce from this information? Pause and identify what you would state here. Here the answer is coming up. Nothing in particular deduced from this. The fact that it's immiscible, you've got something that's non-polar, mark for that. Or the fact that it does not have any OH groups. When you have a molecule that has OH groups present, it can hydrogen bond with water, and such molecules like ethanol will be able to bond favorably with the water molecules and therefore dissolve in water and be miscible with it. And the fact that it is less dense, in other words it floats on top of the water, again something that you wouldn't perhaps necessarily have thought of recording. If the volumes, you may wonder, how do you know which is which? If the two volumes are quite different, for example, if you have a smaller volume of the organic substance, then you should see where the smaller volume is, presumably in this case on the top, indicating that it's less dense than the water. So think in terms of different volumes of the water and the organic mixture. The flame is smoky or yellow. What can you read from that? Again, I have a slide coming up shortly that will look at this in more detail, but what you're supposed to elucidate from that is that it's smoky because it's unsaturated or it has a high carbon content. We'll see that when we're looking at the carbon to hydrogen ratio, the bigger the carbon to hydrogen ratio, the more smoky it is. In fact, I've looked at it the other way around, the hydrogen to carbon ratio. So the bigger this is, the more smoky it is, or the smaller this is, the smokier it is. And of course, the positive test with the bromine water indicates that you have an unsaturated substance or an alkene. And there's your answer in terms of that aspect. Just picking up a little bit on the theory there. If you had, for example, cyclohexene, of course, ethene, propene, butene, those are all gases. So you know you haven't got an alkene like that. But you could take cyclohexene and you see what the cyclohexene molecule looks like here. It's a liquid, that's the advantage of working with cyclohexene. It's a liquid, but it gives typical alkene chemistry. Much easier to be working with a liquid than a gas. And there's your carbon-carbon double bond in cyclohexene. And if you were to mix cyclohexene with water, this is what would happen. The cyclohexene would float on the top because it's less dense. I've written here that only a very weak permanent dipole exists in that molecule. So it's essentially non-polar. Okay, sorry again about another interruption there. Let's move on. So I think we've got what we need from that slide. Remember that rule, like dissolves like. This chemical here is non-polar. Water here is polar. They therefore are immiscible. They do not dissolve in one another. Picking up on hydrogen bonding, how come ethanol, which is also an organic substance, does dissolve in water? This is our ethanol molecule here, and we see in better detail down here what happens in hydrogen bonding. First of all, in water, these are two water molecules here, And if you take a pause for a moment and take a look at the details of the water molecules, you'll see how the hydrogen bonds form. This is the oxygen here bonded to the hydrogens. Again, an oxygen here bonded to hydrogens here and here. A hydrogen bond, in my definition I like, is where hydrogen acts as a bridge, it's acting as a bridge between two electronegative atoms, an oxygen here and an oxygen here, holding one. So here's the hydrogen question. It's where hydrogen acts as a bridge, so this hydrogen here is acting as a bridge between two electronegative atoms, in this case they're both oxygens, holding one by a normal covalent bond. In terms of the normal covalent bond, that's it here, holding one by a normal covalent bond and the other by an electrostatic attraction. Say that all again. It's where hydrogen here acts as a bridge between two electronegative atoms, holding one by a normal covalent bond and the other by an electrostatic attraction. You see the significance of the non-bonding electron pairs there in the oxygen, or of the oxygen. There's a non-bonding electron pair there and there, and indeed in this molecule as well. And that's of significance in terms of strengthening that bond between the hydrogen and the oxygen. That's a hydrogen bond. That's a relatively strong type of intermolecular force. Now, in the case of ethanol, something similar happens. Sorry, ethanol we've got here, it's supposed to ethanol. This is ethanol, which is of significance in your organic chemistry as well. I wanted to pick up on this point because carbonyls, that's to say aldehydes and ketones, are also miscible with water, and this isn't necessarily always explained. The ethanol is easy to see because the ethanol has got, if you look up here at the top left, the ethanol has got in it, sorry, that's the C double bond O, should be circling this bit, there's the OH. So ethanol has got OHs in it, and we can understand why that would be able to hydrogen bond with water molecules. Why, however, is it possible for aldehydes and ketones to hydrogen bond? Well, the reason is on the oxygen of the C double bond O, that's the functional group present in both aldehydes and ketones, we also have a non-bonding electron pair. And there again you may see that hydrogen is acting as a bridge. Here's the hydrogen in question here. Hydrogen is acting as a bridge between two electronegative atoms. Again, in this case they're both oxygens, holding one by a normal covalent bond and the other by an electrostatic attraction. So aldehydes are soluble in water, or miscible with water. Ketones are as well. Alcohols are, and indeed carboxylic acids, because in a carboxylic acid you've also got these OHs. The ones that are immiscible, to bear in mind, would be the esters. Esters have no OH bonds and are not able to hydrogen bond. Moving on. Returning to why some hydrocarbons burn with a very smoky flame. If you pause and take a look at the so-called hydrogen-carbon ratio, and I am aware that books generally talk about the ratio the other way around, the carbon-to-hydrogen ratio, but in this instance let's deal with hydrogen-to-carbon ratio. Methane, the first member of the alkane homologous series, has got one carbon and four hydrogens. Its hydrogen-carbon ratio is 4:1. And that's a very big hydrogen. That is a very big hydrogen to carbon ratio, and it burns extremely well with a very clean flame. As you move to the next member, ethane, the ratio falls because you have two carbons and six hydrogens, 6:2, ratio is 3, and so on. If you go to propane, C3H8, it's falling again to 2.67. By the time you get down to a very long chain alkane like C30. They're always twice as many hydrogens plus 2, so C30, H62. It's fallen from 4 in methane way down to almost 2. So you can see the hydrogen-carbon ratio is falling as you descend here. Another way of looking at it is that the carbon-to-hydrogen ratio is increasing. So you could say that this long-chain hydrocarbon has got a higher carbon content. And that's the way the literature tends to put it across. So if you've got a higher carbon content, or in my way of putting it, you have a lower hydrogen to carbon ratio, the flame gets sootier, begins to look like this. And the significance of this is shown at the bottom here. The black smoke and soot is caused by unburnt carbon, so as well as being environmentally bad, producing all this smoke and soot, it's also from an economic point of view bad, because some of the carbon is not burning to form CO2, and as a result you're getting less energy released. Now, in the context of the observation deduction we've just been looking at, the alkene present in the hydrocarbon mixture might well have been cyclohexane, which is a liquid at room temperature. Look at its hydrogen carbon ratio, 1.67, and that's very low. In other words, it's got a low hydrogen carbon ratio, or a very high carbon content, which would explain why it should burn with a sooty flame. Look where ethanol is, it's fairly high. Its hydrogen to carbon ratio is 3. But also of significance is the fact that it has some inbuilt oxygen in that hydroxyl group, which helps it to burn, obviously. And this diagram here at the top left-hand corner shows what's known as a spirit burner, which might be used in a restaurant to keep the food hot after it's been cooked. And you can see it burns with a blue flame that is very clean. I set on fire here and photographed a number of different organic chemicals. This was ethanol, which burned with a very clean flame. Hexane, that's C6H, 2 6s are 12 plus 2 is 14. Hexane is the liquid, is the fuel used quite often in cigarette lighters. It burns with a fairly clean flame. A little bit of black smoke might be visible there. Cyclohexane, C6H12, and cyclohexane, C6H10. You notice as we go along here that the hydrogen to carbon ratio is falling, or that the carbon content is increasing. And I think you'll see there that we have the most black smoke with the cyclohexane. Picking up on the chemistry for the bromine water is orange-brown. It reacts with the alkene to form a colourless product. If it was ethene, it would form 1,2-dibromoethane, notice ene, because we no longer have that double bond and it resembles an alkane more than an alkene. Significance is this is orange-brown and the product is colourless, so it decolorises the brown or orange-brown bromine water. If it was cyclohexane, we can represent cyclohexane like this with a hexagon with one of the bonds doubled up, and it would react to form this product, which is 1,2-dibromocyclohexane. And again, we're going from a mixture that's coloured to a mixture that's colourless. Let's try another question. So this time it's labelled Y. Again, you're testing to see if it's miscible. You're burning it to see, to observe its carbon content. Is it high or low? If its carbon content is high, it's going to be smoky. If its carbon content is relatively low, then it's going to burn with a clean flame. You're adding acidified potassium dichromate, which can be written Cr2O7 2- oblique stroke H+. This is the way the chemist typically writes this. And it is read as acidified. This is acidified dichromate, or acidified potassium dichromate. That is orange in colour. And if it's added to something with warming that causes it to go from orange to green, it means that that substance will undergo oxidation. Of course, what's happening to the dichromate as it behaves as an oxidizing agent, it is itself reduced, and it's reduced from its orange oxidation state to its green oxidation state. Let's see the observations made in this particular instance. It's described as being colourless. State the obvious, it's a liquid, you get a mark. And any reference to its smell, that kind of organic, oily type smell. This in fact is a picture of George Bush smelling the very stuff. When you added 5 drops to water, it was found to mix, so it was miscible. And that, to me, or that should rule out alkanes and alkenes, of course, but it rules in alcohols, and it does rule in, although it may not state it, it does rule in aldehydes and ketones as well. Then you're burning it and you're getting a blue flame like this. It's no reference to any smoke, so it has a relatively low carbon content or a high hydrogen to carbon ratio. The fact that the dichromate's going from orange to green, it's being reduced, means that it's behaving as an oxidizing agent, and this chemical is allowing itself to be oxidized. It's not if it's an alcohol, it's not a tertiary alcohol, because tertiary alcohols can't be oxidized, but it could be a primary or a secondary alcohol because they can be oxidized. This is the color change you get from orange potassium dichromate. It's too dark to see the color here, but it's a very dark green color. Now, the deductions that we can make from this, pause and have a go at making your own deductions, please. Here they are coming up. So from the fact that it's a colourless clear liquid and the alcohol type smell, you should smell the alcohol and you should be able to recognise the alcohol type smell. This is what you're required to reason. But they're accepting just that it's organic in nature. Or even if you're specific as saying that it's ethanol, but of course you can't say that it's ethanol just on the basis of those observations. The fact that it mixes, again, they're ruling out, while they shouldn't be ruling out aldehydes and ketones, they're ruling them out and saying, well, it's indicating an alcohol. And from the fact that it's dissolving, it's showing the presence of OH groups. And that's explaining why it's soluble or miscible with water. The blue flame is indicating a relatively low carbon content, and therefore that it's saturated. That is, that it doesn't have carbon-carbon double bonds. Or again, you see that there's a mark for indicating that it's an alcohol, being reasoned from the nature of the flame. So take note of the kind of flame you get with an alcohol. It burns with a clean blue flame, and I'm not terribly happy with that. That it's, you know, it's not as obvious a blue colour as that, I have to say. It's more of a sort of a orange yellow blue flame in my opinion. And with the potassium dichromate, the fact that it goes from orange to green, it means the material has been oxidized, and it's ruling then in, if you've narrowed it down to an alcohol, then primary, secondary. The problem I have with this, I have to say, is that aldehydes are, apart from the smell, the other things would not rule out an aldehyde. Ethanol will be miscible with water. It will burn, though it'll burn with a sootier flame, so I suppose we could rule it out on the basis of that because it's got a higher carbon content. But it is oxidizable. And just a reminder again of why the alcohol is miscible with water, because of the ability to form hydrogen bonds. A reminder again of that slide, looking at the hydrogen to carbon ratio, or looking at it the other way around, looking at the carbon content. The carbon content is increasing as we go down, and it's getting sootier. This is the relative position of ethanol. It's got a relatively low carbon content and burns with a clean flame. It's got that inbuilt oxygen, which also helps it to burn, of course. Here's the equation, balanced equation. And in terms of the oxidation, this is the acidified potassium dichromate, which has got chromium in its plus 6 oxidation state. And this is chromium in the plus 3 oxidation state, which is green in colour. It's an excellent oxidising agent. 1 mole of this will soak up 6 moles of electrons. Remember, oil rig, the mnemonic oil rig, oxidation is loss, reduction is gain. When a substance is oxidized, it loses electrons, and 1 mole of potassium dichromate can take away 6 moles of electrons. You should build up your confidence with these redox equations. This explains the significance of the acid why you need to acidify the dichromate, or indeed any oxidizing agent, to help it work. You see that in here you have seven oxygens and they turn into seven water molecules. How many hydrogens have you in seven water molecules? 14. And that's the significance of the 14H+ from the acid. It is, so to speak, mopping up the oxygens, turning them into water molecules. The oxidation state of the chromium is going from +6 to +3. In fact, you have two chromiums. So two chromiums +6 going to two chromiums +3. That's the significance of the 6 electrons, or 6 moles of electrons. If you're writing a balanced equation for this oxidation process of ethanol to, for example, ethanol, you should use this symbol, square brackets with O inside, to represent oxidation. What's happening is we're losing this hydrogen and one of these hydrogens, which combine with the water to give you the H2O. And then we're getting ethanol, the aldehyde, formed. Let's move on to another question. Pause and try to read into the significance of these tests as to what might be present. A carbonate, sodium carbonate, that's looking obviously for acid. And indeed the magnesium is also looking for acid. And of course, if we're dealing with organic chemicals, we're looking for a carboxylic acid. These are the observations. Sorry, I don't have next slide. The next slide hasn't come out, so I'll just give you the results here. Vinegar smell is what you're expected to come up with here. In terms of the effect of the pH paper, you observe that it goes orange red in color. They therefore accept anything in the range pH 2 to 5. Here you do get effervescence or bubbling. Then, stating the obvious, it dissolves in the acid. You get a colorless solution. And in terms of the test, using a suitable reagent, one would be expected to use lime water, and it goes cloudy. A positive test for CO2 gas given off, and therefore the fact that an acid must have been present that reacted with the metal carbonate gave a salt, CO2 and water. And of course carboxylic acid would react with magnesium to give a salt and hydrogen gas. And here again you'll expect to see effervescence. You'll again expect to see it dissolve, and you'll get a colourless solution. And in this particular case the reaction is exothermic, so you should feel the test tube and find that the temperature rises. And here it hasn't asked you to identify the gas, so no marks for that. Here we've got some magnesium ribbon and I drop some into a test tube and you're getting effervescence here. This is what you'll observe, bubbling. You were not required to test the gas, but if you were, you could take a second test tube and hold it upside down over that test tube. Hydrogen is lighter than air. It'll rise up here and collect in the test tube above, and then you can test that using a lighted splint and it should give a pop. The reason that you wouldn't be asked to do this is because when you're working with organic chemicals, you try your best not to have any naked flames, because these organic chemicals are usually flammable. So here are the observations. Pause and write down your deductions from these, what you think would be required. Do give it a go. Well, here are the deductions. The smell should lead you to conclude that it's a carboxylic acid. The fact that its pH is in the range 2 to 5, so the pH, acidic pH, indicates carboxylic acid. Effervescence with the carbonate again is indicating that it's acidic in nature. and the gas is carbon dioxide, of course. It is a neutralization reaction. It's an acid plus a metal carbonate. Metal carbonate's a base, so it's an acid plus a base, therefore neutralization. The reaction of the magnesium with the organic material, we had effervescence, and again that's indicating that it must be acidic to be reacting the magnesium in that manner. You're not asked to test for the gas, but you could say that the gas possibly is hydrogen. So we've identified it to be a carboxylic acid. You'll be aware that vinegar is a 5% solution typically of ethanoic acid and water. And the reactions involved in this particular case, we have ethanoic acid reacting with sodium carbonate in one of those steps, forming a salt, CO2, and water. The particular salt is sodium ethanoate, which could be written like this. The ethanoate ion, of course, looks like so. But it's just another negative ion, which could be represented as A-. So sodium ethanoate could be written as NaA. Magnesium ethanoate could be written as MgA2. So ethanoic acid magnesium gives magnesium ethanoate or ethanoate and hydrogen. And you see up here the color that the indicator paper will go with ethanoic acid. Let's move on to another question. Here we're distinguishing between three different haloalkanes, chloro, bromo, and iodo. And we're looking at the strength of the CX bond. As we go down the group, chlorine, bromine, iodine, and we're looking at this CX bond, what happens is the CX bond is getting weaker. Now the polarity is decreasing as well. And these two different observations lead us to contrary conclusions as to which should react the fastest. The delta positive charge in this carbon is going to be greater than the delta positive charge in this carbon of the Ci, given that the Ci bond is less polar. That results because iodine is less electronegative than chlorine. One, because this is nucleophilic substitution, when it comes to the nucleophile, which you can represent like this, when it approaches the carbon with the delta positive charge, clearly the bigger the delta positive charge in the carbon, the more strongly it will attract the nucleophile. On the basis of that, one might have expected the CCl to react faster. However, the strength of the CX bond is weakening as we go down, and a weaker CX bond would result in a faster reaction. These run contrary to one another, so the question is which one wins out, and you should know from the theory that the one that wins out is the strength of the bond. And as we go down, the bond gets weaker and the reaction occurs faster, so we expect the iodo to react faster. Now what happens is that CX bond breaks as a result of reacting with the hydroxide ions, and as a result we get COH bond formed, in other words an alcohol, and we get the X released as an ion. Now if silver nitrate is present, the moment that X shows up, it's going to react, in other words the halide ion Cl- Br- I-, the moment it is released from the haloalkane, it will react with the silver nitrate immediately, forming a precipitate of silver halide, AgX. Now because the iodo reacts fastest, we expect that it will form a precipitate quickest. It should be a yellow precipitate of silver iodide. And the slowest to form will be the one with the chloroalkane. Okay, so this is how this particular experiment worked. These were the observations you made. The case of P, that you got a white precipitate, or because it's so slow, they accept that in the time given in the experiment, sometimes the student doesn't have enough time to actually have a precipitate form. So either a white precipitate or no precipitate was accepted. This must be the by the signs of the cream precipitate. This must be the iodo. Sorry, I beg your pardon, the bromo. And then with the yellow precipitate, and the fact that it was the fastest clearly indicates the iodo. So this is leading me to conclude that or then is the or I haloalkane, that Q is the or Br, and that P is the or Cl, the chloroalkane. And that's what you see here. Those are the deductions that you're required to make. Now, so far, we haven't had any particular organic observation deduction involving the iodoform reaction. So let's take a look at the iodoform reaction in some detail here. First of all, this is what iodoform looks like. Its proper name is triiodomethane. Think of what methane looks like, carbon with four hydrogens. If you replace three of those hydrogens with an iodine atom, then you get triiodomethane. Because iodine is a relatively large molecule, a large atom, we end up with a molecule of high molecular mass. It has a weak resultant dipole moment. But with its relatively high molecular mass, it has relatively strong van der Waals forces, and it exists as a solid at room temperature and pressure. It is insoluble in water, so if it's formed in an aqueous solution, it will immediately precipitate out. And it precipitates out as fine yellow precipitate that has an antiseptic or hospital type smell. Now, in this so-called iodoform reaction or iodoform test, we're testing for the presence of an alcohol like this. Look at this bit shaded in gold here. The carbon that holds the OH group, if it has a methyl group attached directly to it and a hydrogen, then it will give a positive iodoform reaction. The other group, labelled OR here, could be a hydrogen or a methyl or any alkyl group for that matter, or indeed could even be a phenyl group C6H5. Any such alcohol, that's to say, that where the C that holds the OH also has a methyl and a hydrogen attached, will give a positive iodoform reaction. Now, it is worth noting that because in the first step of this reaction, it's a three-step reaction, this iodoform reaction, in the first step, the alcohol is oxidized to the corresponding aldehyde or ketone. So you shouldn't be surprised to find that some aldehydes and ketones also give a positive iodoform reaction. And it's worth taking a moment just to see which type do. Aldehydes and ketones have this in common, they have a C double bond O. And if you find an aldehyde or a ketone where the C of the C double bond O has attached to it a methyl group, and the other group OR can be again a H, a methyl, ethyl, propyl, etc., or indeed a C6H5, an aryl group or benzene group, they too will give a positive iodoform reaction. But you'll see perhaps when we get to the end that really they have just been formed from this particular type of grouping in the first of three steps in the iodoform reaction itself. Let's focus then on the alcohols. Which alcohols will give a positive iodoform reaction? Let's look at this one here first of all, methanol. Doesn't come out very well, let's just raise that, try a different colour. This here is methanol. Stop for a moment and see if you think this will give a positive iodoform reaction. Well, here's the C that's holding the functional group. Does it have a methyl group and a hydrogen attached? Well, it's got lots of hydrogens, but it has no methyl group, therefore it will not give a positive iodoform reaction. What about this one, ethanol? Stop for a moment and decide whether it should give a positive iodoform reaction. Here's the carbon holding the functional group, the hydroxyl group. Has it got a methyl group? Yes, there's the methyl group. Has it got a hydrogen? Yes, there's the hydrogen. As long as this other group, the so-called OR group, can be a hydrogen or any alkyl or a phenyl group. What about this one here? This is propan one all, will it give a positive iodoform reaction? Well, here's the C holding the OH. Does it have a methyl group attached? No, it doesn't have. It's got this big group, which is an ethyl group. It has a hydrogen, right enough, but it has no methyl group. That will not give a positive iodoform reaction. This here is a position isomer of the previous one. This is propan-2-ol. Will it give a positive iodoform reaction? Here's the carbon holding the OH group. Has it got a methyl group attached? Yes, in fact, it's got two. Has it a hydrogen attached? Yes, it has. That will therefore give a positive iodoform reaction, or positive test with the iodoform reaction. Stop a moment and take in the significance of this, which is given here. Ethanol is the only primary alcohol to give the iodoform reaction, this particular one here. Remember the importance of having the methyl group attached to the carbon that has the OH group. So once you get to propan-1-ol here, it no longer has the methyl group, so for that reason ethanol is the only primary alcohol. And you saw indeed that methanol, also a primary alcohol, is missing the methyl group. So because ethanol is the only primary alcohol that has a methyl attached to the carbon holding the OH group, it's the only one that gives the positive iodoform test. If the OR group is a hydrocarbon group, then you have a secondary alcohol. And as a result, lots of secondary alcohols give this reaction. But those that do all have a methyl group attached to the carbon holding the OH group. And of course, no tertiary alcohols give a positive iodoform reaction. Why? Because with a tertiary alcohol, like for example this one, what are we missing? We're missing the hydrogen. So no tertiary alcohols give a positive iodoform reaction. Just taking a moment to look at the carbonyls, namely the aldehydes and ketones, that give a positive iodoform reaction. We take a look at the C double bond O. We look at the carbon of the C double bond O, and it must have a methyl group attached to it. This is missing the methyl group, so this will not give a positive test with iodoform. Here the carbon of the C double bond O has a methyl group attached, and the hydrogen there for the OR group. The OR group, remember, can be H or any alkyl or phenyl group. What about this one? It does have the hydrogen, but it is missing a methyl group, so it will not give a positive test for iodoform. What about this one, the ketone, propanone? It's got the methyl group, and the other group can be either hydrogen or any alkyl group, so again it has all that's required, and therefore propanone will give a positive iodoform reaction. In fact, it says here all the tuones, as far as ketones are concerned, will give a positive iodoform reaction. But there's only one aldehyde that will give a positive iodoform reaction, and that's ethanol. So ethanol and all the tuones give a positive iodoform reaction. Turning to the actual test, unfortunately there are two versions of the iodoform reaction, or two versions of the iodoform test, though you'll see that there's a strong overlap between the two. In the iodoform test, you will have hydroxide ions present and iodine present in solution. You will be aware that iodine is insoluble in water, but if you put it into potassium iodide solution, then it forms the I3- ion, which is soluble. But common to both versions of the iodoform test are hydroxide ions and iodine. This, in fact, is what iodoform looks like. It's a pale yellow solid. Remember its structure. Triiodomethane. It's a solid that has an antiseptic or hospital type smell. So here in the first version I've taken some iodine dissolved in potassium iodide solution, and here's my sample. I've chosen a particular sample that gives a positive iodoform reaction, for example ethanol or propan-2-ol, this is the iodine dissolved potassium iodide, which is a dark red-brown liquid. So to about 5 cubic centimeters of this saturated iodine solution, you add a small amount of your sample, about 5 drops of your test solution. Next you add sodium hydroxide solution, dilute sodium hydroxide. You do so slowly and carefully until the colour almost has gone. So this is what it looks like to begin with, and we begin adding the sodium hydroxide slowly. And you notice it beginning to change and go cloudy. Here the solution is clear, but here it's cloudy. And this is an indication or a sign that a precipitate is forming. The iodoform is forming, in other words. And if you smell it at this stage, you'll get that antiseptic smell. It may then go on to pale in colour and look like this. Sometimes it's necessary to warm it slightly to help the reaction. You can simply place the test tube in a hot water bath at about 70 degrees C. Let's take up the chemistry that's going on here. So there are three distinct steps. First of all, the iodine oxidizes the alcohol to the corresponding carbonyl. So in the simple case, if we have ethanol here, if we oxidize that, then we'll get the corresponding carbonyl, which will be ethanol, like so. In the second step, the three hydrogens of the methyl group, in other words these three hydrogens, 1, 2, 3, they are all substituted by iodine atoms. And then thirdly, that particular chemical then, with the hydrogens replaced by iodines, breaks apart in the presence of the hydroxide ions to produce the triiodomethane together with this. As I say, it's sometimes necessary to stand the test tube in a hot water bath for 2 or 3 minutes to confirm this test. And here in this diagram we see various stages in the process, from the dark red brown colour here that we have initially. We see the solution begin to lighten in colour, but it's still a solution that's clear, and then we begin to see it go cloudy, and we have in there the fine yellow precipitate of triiodomethane. And those yellow crystals that are formed of the iodoform or triiodomethane have an antiseptic smell, a bit like TCP. And you should pause this slide and take a look at the specific reactions that are taking place. The iodine in the presence of the alkali brings about the oxidation of the alcohol to the corresponding carbonyl. In the second step, the iodine, again in the presence of the alkali, goes on to replace these three hydrogens. And then in the final step, the alkali causes this to split. And you see this is a balanced equation here. The H of the NaOH is going in here to form the CHI3, the triiodomethane. And then we're getting the sodium salt of the acid. Again, you see the steps. We start with a dark red-brown solution of iodine and potassium iodide. We begin adding sodium hydroxide. The colour initially begins to lighten. And then we see it begin to go from a clear solution to a suspension. It goes cloudy. We have the precipitate forming. And then it may lighten to this colour. And if you smell, you'll get that antiseptic smell. This is a version that I carried out here, and you can see it at the cloudy. This is where it begins to go cloudy, and you have the precipitate. You may see just about see it here, the precipitate beginning to form there, fine precipitate of triiodomethane. There is a second version of this, and your particular specification seems to favour this. The literature would indicate that this is a cheaper method of doing the test, because buying iodine itself is relatively expensive, or certainly more expensive than creating it by this method. But again, you'll see common to this will be hydroxide ions and iodine. But the iodine will be produced in situ, what is called in situ. In other words, it'll be produced there and then as part of the reaction, as part of the sequence of reactions. In this particular test, we use then sodium chlorate, also known as sodium chlorate 1 or sodium hypochlorite, which is the active ingredient in many household bleaches, and potassium iodide, which is a white crystalline solid. We have solutions of these two, which are both colourless and clear. Now, the sodium chlorate oxidises the iodide ions in the potassium iodide, producing iodine. And this is one of the first observations that you'll note. When you add the colourless clear sodium chlorate 1 to the colourless clear solution of potassium iodide, first thing you'll notice is it begins to yellow, or to turn yellow-brown in colour. And that can be explained by the fact that this oxidising agent, sodium chlorate 1, is oxidising the iodide ions, removing electrons to form iodine. While the iodide is colourless, the iodine is coloured red-brown, and that's what we should see forming. As a result, now you have iodine, I2, present. Sodium chlorate 1 is also alkaline in nature, so there will be some hydroxide ions present as well. So in effect, you see that this really is a slightly different version of what we saw just a few moments ago. We have the iodine and the hydroxide ions, which will bring about the same result. So you start with your sample, a relatively small amount, and you add the potassium iodide, which is a colourless clear liquid. They will be miscible, but there will be no change in colour at that point. So you have your sample, you've added the potassium iodide, they're miscible, but no change in colour. You then add the sodium chlorate 1, which will liberate iodine from the potassium iodide, and the iodine will then begin to carry out the steps we saw earlier. It will oxidize the alcohol to the corresponding carbonyl. In the presence of hydroxide ions, it will replace the hydrogens of the methyl group, and then the hydroxide ions will produce the precipitate of triiodomethane with the antiseptic smell. And here's a summary of all of that. You might like to pause and read what's on this slide. Remind you again, you start with your sample that you're testing for iodoform, perhaps an alcohol. You add to it potassium iodide. You then slowly add the potassium chlorate 1, sodium chlorate 1, or sodium hypochlorite, it's also called. And then you watch what happens. It should begin to go light brown in colour, then begin to pale and turn yellow in colour. And at that point then you should begin to see the fine yellow precipitate and observe an antiseptic smell. And that completes our look. You can revisit this particular snapcast at any time and scroll through to the particular part that you want to revise. I hope that you'll have found that useful. Thank you for listening.